Let us move over to ATM concepts now. Look at the figures. ATM architecture has a fixed length cell. An ATM cell is a short fixed length of block of data that contains a short header with addressing information followed by the upper layer traffic or payload. So it has got a header and a payload. The cell structure is seen in the figure. It is 53 bytes long with 5 byte header and 48 bytes of payload. 5 byte header, 48 bytes of payload put together is a 53 bytes fixed length cell, and that is the hallmark of ATM. The short packet in a way may appear to be somewhat inefficient in its ratio of overhead to actual data, but it definitely has some distinct advantages over the other alternatives that are possible. By fixing the length of each cell, the timing characteristics such as propagation, delay and so on of these links and the corresponding network are predictable. Please note that if the packets are of variable length, predicting the performance dynamics is very difficult. By using a short fixed length cells, hardware design also becomes quite easy. Finally, the use of short cell provides an ability to transfer asynchronous information with a very short delay. Now, the information contained in the header of each cell is used to identify the circuit of the local link, carries local flow control information, and includes error detection to prevent cells from being misrouted. The remaining 48 octets or 48 bytes are routed through the network to the destination using the circuit. This is the payload or the actual information that needs to be carried. We may ask a question, why fixed length cells or why short cells? ATM, as we have seen so far now, switches fixed length 53 byte cells. It provides predictability in delay variance. Predictable delay in turn enables traffic such as voice and video to be transported without distortion. Smaller cells take less time to fill with data. Uniform size cells can be switched faster. So you have predictability, you have capability to transport multiple signals, and it's filled up very fast, and also the transmission becomes faster. All these things are the advantages of using fixed length short cells. This concept of cell switching in ATM and packet switching in LAN is also brought out in the other two figures that are appearing on your screen now. In this slide, let's look at another important concept of ATM, virtual path and virtual channels. What's a virtual path and a virtual channel? Look at the figures that are on your screen now. A two-tiered addressing scheme is used, with the following elements being involved in the addressing assignments. let's look at the virtual channel. A virtual channel represents the flow of a single network connection data flow between two ATM end users. The ATM standards define this as an unidirectional connection between two endpoints on the network. A virtual channel is a concept used to describe transport of ATM cells associated by a common virtual channel identifier. So each virtual channel will have a virtual channel identifier. Now what is a virtual channel identifier? That's the next question. A VCI describes a unidirectional transport of ATM cells. VCI is used in conjunction with the VPI to identify the next destination of a cell as it passes through a series of switch routers on its way to destination. So VCI-VPI combination will talk about next destination of the cell. Okay, let's move on to what is virtual path. A virtual path is used to carry one or more virtual channels through the network. It is represented as a bundle or collection of channels between the two endpoints. The figure will bring out this concept very clearly. Please look at the figure. What is a virtual path identifier that we have been talking in connection with VCI? VPI identifies a unidirectional transport of ATM cells belonging to a bundle of virtual channels. VPI is used in conjunction with VCI. We have already seen this. A virtual path consists of multiple virtual channels to the same endpoint. The last one is virtual circuit descriptor. A unique number as per AIP that identifies to the AIP which VPI or VCI to use for a particular packet. Look at the animation that is appearing on your screen now. The logical grouping of paths and channels helps in managing the addressing of the flow of information through an ATM network. From the figure, the student can get a fairly good idea of how ATM networks are organized. The figure shows a sample configuration of a network with some virtual paths and virtual channels. Each virtual path contains one or more virtual channels. Please note that the actual numbers assigned to each of the paths and channels represent a single virtual path or channel segment between two adjacent nodes of the network. Please note all these numbers refer to between two adjacent nodes in the network.